So let's get started with the energy equation. Same as Newton's second law, we will invoke thermodynamics. What does first law of thermodynamics say? So increment, change in the energy, internal energy of the system is equal to heat transfer to the system plus work done on the system. So if I take a total derivative, this internal energy per unit mass of the system consists of the kinetic component, kinetic energy component. For those of you who cannot see this, it is u squared plus v squared by 2. I am taking 2 dimensional, I am not taking 3 dimensional because it becomes too lengthy. And thermal internal energy is given by Cv into T. Okay. So, if I write this internal energy change and the heat transfer to the system and to the work done on the system in terms of moving system, that is if I apply control volume approach, that is if I apply the substantial derivative, I get dE by dT equal to dQ by dT dW by dT. Note that this is substantial derivative, note that this is total derivative. So now if I do that, remember what was there on the left hand side, dE by dT. So dE by dT, that is if I have to write rate of increase of energy E of fluid element equal to rate of heat transfer to fluid element and rate of work done on the fluid element by surface and body forces. See, where is this derivation I have taken from? We have taken this derivation from, if anyone wants to see the original where this derivation has taken from, this is boundary layer flows by Sebassi and Bradshaw. It is a wonderful book. If anyone wants to read and understand much about convective heat transfer, this is the book. I forget exactly the author's name, Sebassi and Bradshaw, but sorry, the title. I think if I am right, it is boundary layer flows. I am not too sure about this. If someone is really interested, if you put the question in Moodle, I will put it across in the Moodle. So, okay. So, this is rate of increase of energy E of fluid element equal to rate of heat transfer to the fluid element plus rate of work done on the fluid element by surface and body forces. Okay. But then I have to apply this for control volume. So, applying Reynolds transport theorem, rate of increase of E in Cv, it is like you remember always this business of E dot in minus E dot out plus E dot g equal to E dot st. Essentially, I am doing that only, nothing new. You should not get lost at all. This is rate of increase of E in Cv, okay, and rate at which E is entering through the surface of Cv and rate at which E is leaves through surface of Cv. And now, who is doing the heat transfer? Heat is transferred to the fluid element by conduction. And who is doing the work? Who can do the work? Only the forces which are acting. And we had realized in the momentum equation derivation, the forces acting are surface forces and body forces. So, those are the rate at which the surface and body forces are doing their work on my control volume is this rate of surface. This is that term. Now, let us take only the left hand side, To understand this left hand side, what are we up to? That is the rate of increase of internal energy in the control volume, rate at which the internal energy enters and rate at which the internal energy leaves. The best way to do is to take the control volume, okay? That is what I have done in this next transparency. So, if you do this, this is the control volume. I think we are all well familiar with this control volume approach now, delta x, delta y, delta z. Okay? So, the internal energy entering is E, capital E, but how much it can enter? Mass flow rate in the x direction into the internal energy per unit mass, which is that is rho u dy dz, that is rho area is dy dz into velocity rho u. So, this is the internal energy entering, getting out is by Taylor's expansion series. By now, you are well familiar with this. The same term rho u e dy dz plus dou of rho e u upon del x dx dy dz. Is that okay? Now, similarly in the y direction I have rho e v dx dz and rho e v dx dz plus del by del y of rho e v dy dx dz. And okay, there is a mistake here, del by rho, what is the rate of increase of E in C V? This plus is missing here, and remove this equal to sign and put plus here. Okay. So, that is del rho E by del T, what is this term? What is this term? Rate of increase of E in C V. So, this is del of rho E by del T plus, why I have only one term? Because this is, this term is plus minus of this term, that means this term and this term get cancelled out. Similarly, this term and this term get cancelled out. I am left out with del rho E by del T plus del rho E u by del x plus del rho E v by del y dx dy dz. Is that okay? What is this term? This is the left hand side of this my energy equation which I had formulated. Let us keep it like that, let us keep it like that. Now, let us take that the same thing and expand that. What am I doing here? I am expanding, keeping rho constant, differentiating E, keeping E constant, differentiating rho, keeping rho u, keeping E constant and differentiating rho u, keeping rho u constant and differentiating E. Similarly, keeping E constant, differentiating rho v and keeping rho v constant, differentiating E. So, what do I, if I group this, that is I take this term and then this term and take out E, what is this term? This is nothing but my continuity equation. So, this whole of this vanishes. So, I am left out with rho del E del T plus rho u del E del x plus rho v del E del y. I am not going to keep telling all the time dx dy dz because it is there in the back of the minds all the time. So, I have rho del E del T plus rho u del E del x plus rho v rho e del rho del E by del y. So, what is this term? What is this term? E is changing not only with time but also changing with space x and y by virtue of velocities u and v. So, I have, this is a total derivative. So, rho d by dt of E. What is E? I told in the first transparency, E is sum of internal energy and thermal internal energy. I am using for both the terms, capital E, I am saying internal energy, but small e is thermal internal energy because of virtue, by virtue of temperature that exists. Okay. So, E is CVT for those guys who have forgotten that, plus u squared plus v squared by 2 because I have taken only 2d. Okay. So, this is my, what is this? This is my left hand side, that is the rate of, what is the change of E with respect to space and time we have accounted for. But now, what is that I need to account? What is that I need to account? If you remember, what was that we said? Rate of heat transfer into CV by conduction. That is the first term on the right hand side of my energy equation. Simply nothing we are doing, you do not have to get carried away or lost with these equations. Okay. So, for those guys who are forgotten, why are we deriving this equation? Why are we deriving this energy equation? For getting temperature distribution from momentum equation, we intend to get velocity profile or velocity distribution. From energy equation, we are supposed to get, from energy equation, we are supposed to get temperature distribution. Why do I need temperature distribution? H, remember H equal to minus k del T by del y at y equal to 0 upon T s minus T infinity. To get this temperature gradient, we are setting up an energy equation. So, that we get temperature distribution, let us not forget this, let us not forget this. Okay. So, now we get back to rate of heat conduction into control volume by conduction. So, this is I guess pretty straightforward. Why I say straightforward? Because essentially this is what we did in heat diffusion equation. So, Q x dot is the heat transfer in the x direction, that is entering, Q x dot into area dy dz, and Q x dot dy dz plus del Q x dot by del x dx dy dz. Similarly, Q dot y dx dz and Q dot y dx dz plus del Q dot y del y dx dy dz. Now, what is Q dot x? What is Q dot x? Actually, we should be using Q x double dash, but I am replacingly using these notations. Please bear with me for these notations. So, that is minus of, why this minus? Where did this minus come from? In minus out. So, this minus this becomes, these two terms get cancelled out, and I have minus del q x dot by del x. Now, what is q x dot? By Fourier's law of conduction, minus k del t by del x plus del by del y minus, actually minus sign is there for the whole bracket, remember that, del by del y minus k del t by del y dx dy dz. Negative sign arises because heat transfer is counted as positive in the positive coordinate direction. Okay. So, this is just a reminder. So, this is what I get from the, for the rate of heat transfer into control volume by conduction. Now, let me take up rate of work done by pressure forces. So, the term is, if you remember, rate of surface and body forces doing work on control volume. So, first let me take surface forces, means what are those? Pressure force, then I have normal stress, then I have shear stress, then I have to take body force. Similarly, I will take first pressure force, work done by pressure force. So, I have the control volume. Okay. So, what is the pressure force? What is work done by a force? What is work done by a force? Force into velocity, that is what I have written. Rate of doing work is force into velocity. Force is what in the x direction because of pressure? P into dy dz into u. Okay. So, actually there is an important concept here we need to emphasize, students. People ask always, sir, pressure does not have direction. Very right. If we study Pascal's law, if you remember in fluid mechanics, we study that in Pascal's law, P x equal to P y equal to P z equal to P, pressure is independent of direction, that is what Pascal derives. But what are we saying? What are we saying here? Is it pressure in x direction? No, it is the work done because of pressure force, and by virtue of velocity it is taking this direction. So, please remember this when you are telling the student. It is not the pressure which is having the direction, it is the velocity which is giving this direction. So, work is being done in this direction. Okay. So, fine, rate of work doing work is P dy dz into u. So, this is what is acting in this direction, but again which is acting in the inward direction. Someone on the other day when we were signing off on Friday were asking, why pressure is both on the inward direction for temperature and heat flux and all, you are writing one inward and one outward. Pressure can act only inward or outward. We take by notation, then it cannot become pressure, no. If pressure is inward here and pressure is outward here, then nothing is acting. So, pressure can occur either when it is inward or when it is outwards. So, it has to be either inward or outward. This is true for normal stresses also. So, even for shear stresses, it can shear only when it is there in opposite direction. Shearing is essentially because of either tensile or compression, but acting in different direction. So, it has to be in opposing direction. So, please note this, please note this, do not get confused, we are doing whatever we feel like, we are not doing that. Okay. So, P into dy dz into u, and here P u dy dz plus del u p by del x dx dy dz. Similarly, for y direction, P dx dz into v, dv dx dz plus del vp by del y dx dy dz. If I do this budgeting, this is positive. So, this and this get cancelled out, I am ending up with minus del up by del x. Remember, why this is taking negative sign? Because it is in the negative x direction. So, similarly, I end up getting minus del up by del x plus del V p by del y. What is this? This is the work done by pressure force in x and y directions. Now what is the work done by the normal stresses? So, we have normal stresses and shear stresses, sigma x x, sigma x y, sigma x z, sigma y y and sigma x x are the normal stresses, sigma x y, sigma y x and sigma x z, sigma y z are shear stresses. So, the way we did for pressure, again we are doing for energy, for normal stresses, rate of work done by normal stresses. Only thing here is notation is, there is again a mistake here, this should be, this arrow mark should be outward, this should be outward, this is again, this also should be outward, that is this should be downward and this should be left side, this arrow mark, this is a mistake because of, this is simple copy paste mistake, copy paste is a major problem. Okay. So, because I just copy, we just pasted the pressure thing and that is what I did not bother to change this arrow, sorry for that. So, this is sigma x x, so same thing if I put sigma x x dy dz into u, sigma x x u dy dz plus del u sigma x x upon del x, all this volume. Similarly, you have in the y direction. So, what do I end up? This term, this term, this term, this term get cancelled out with each other and I end up with del u sigma x x by del x plus del v sigma y y by del y. Note that these two terms are now positive, unlike pressure, because the notation for both are opposite, that is all. Okay. So, that is why this has become positive. Now, what is the work done by shear stress? So, you have the shear stress sigma y x minus sigma y x, velocity here is v, area is dy dz, and if I expand this by Taylor's expansion, I get sigma y x plus del y x dx, del x into dx into v plus del v by del x into dx dy dz dz. So, when I multiply this, I am going to get sigma y x v del y dz, that gets cancelled out with this and I get multiplication of these two terms that I am neglecting, and that is it. And then I have, what are the other terms? That is it. So, the other terms get neglected because they are small. So, similarly, I have minus sigma x y into u dx dz. I get four terms, sigma y x v dy dz, that is what is this, that gets cancelled out, and the second term is v sigma y x del x dx plus sigma y x del v del x dx, these two are coupled and written as del v sigma y x by del x plus del sigma y x by del x into del v by del x into dx, because these two are pretty small gradients, multiplication of two gradients we are neglecting. So, essentially this is two terms, one term get cancelled out and the other term we are neglecting, this is reducing to two terms, that is what Professor Arun wants me to emphasize. Okay. So, similarly here I get del u sigma x y by del y, remember this is work done by shear stresses. So, next is we have to take stock of everything. So, this is what we got for the rate of increase of internal energy, this is the heat transfer, and these three terms are work done by, this is work done by pressure force, work done by normal stresses, work done by shear stresses, and this is, these two terms are work done by body forces. So, remember here, body force is per unit volume. So, I have to multiply by rho u to make it work done. Okay. So, rho u fx is the work done by body force in x direction, rho v fy is the work done by body force in the y direction. Now, so this is the whole term, you do not have to lose heart because of so many terms. So, now we have the full equation. So now it is just the algebra, there is no thinking business now, it is just the algebra. I will tend to go little fast now. So now let me take, just for the heck of it, let us keep this as A, equation A, keep this in the back of your minds. Now let me take the momentum equation, rho du dt equal to minus del p del x plus del sigma xx by del x plus del sigma yx plus del y plus del sigma zx plus del z plus rho fx. Now let me multiply this by u and divide it by rho, okay. So minus u by rho del p del x plus u by rho del u del sigma xx by del x plus u by rho del sigma yx by del y plus u fx, this is what I get. So now what do I do with this? So u del u by del t, the same thing, I can write this as du squared by 2 dt squared, 2u, 2 gets cancelled, I will be getting u du by dt. So I can write this as du squared by 2, you might be seeing why am I doing this? I am doing this circus essentially to write this equation because I have a term here u squared by 2, I want to do some circus there. So that is the reason I am writing this as a du squared by 2, so I get whole of this. So similarly, I can write v dv by dt as dv squared by 2 dt, and this is written from y momentum equation. If I add these two equations, I get d by dt of u squared by 2 plus v squared by 2, additional term, that is 1 minus 1 by rho u del p by del x plus v del p by del y plus u by rho, this term and then this term and this term. So now what am I doing? I am deducting this equation from equation A. That means this is going to be, if I deduct that, I get on the left hand side u squared plus v squared by 2 get cancelled out. So I get dE by dt and what do I get? Plus the other terms are anyway there, that is these terms are anyway there, these are not going to go anywhere. These two terms are there, that is what I have written here, these two terms. But only thing is that I have made a simplification here. What is that? I have taken k is independent of direction and pulled the k out. So k by rho del square t by del x square plus del square t by del y square. What is the other thing I have done? Can you notice that? What is that other thing I have done? That is u del p by del x plus del v p by del y, and I have here on the right hand side u del p by del x plus v del p by del y. If I expand that, I will be getting two terms will get cancelled out, I get p by rho del u by del x plus del v by del y. So I do not think, I think I will give up doing the algebra and the transparency, I do not think I can do that. So I would request you to please, I cannot do that, a minus b you do and see it for yourself, indeed these are the terms you are going to get. So that is what I am going to get, that is this is, these are the terms you are going to get. So what is sigma xx? We have not yet substituted sigma xx, sigma yx and sigma yy, we already know sigma xx, sigma yy. If I substitute that, if I substitute all those terms, it reduces to this. Essentially what you can see here is that they are nothing but the velocity gradients. I think I have written the same thing little bolder, no, this is, these are the velocity gradients. So this is nothing but, this is what is called as phi, this is what is called as phi, viscous dissipation, because these are all velocity gradients and that is there with viscosity multiplied. So if I substitute that, if I substitute that, I get dE. Do I have reached the goal where I am supposed to reach? Have I reached the goal where am I supposed to reach? Do I see everywhere temperature? No, where I do not see temperature? In E, dE by dt, I do not see temperature. So I need to write this dE by dt in terms of temperature. So that is what I am going to do. So that is E, that is H equal to E plus P by rho. I think we all know H equal to E plus PV. I am not writing it as specific volume, I am putting specific volume as density. So if I take total derivative, dH by dt equal to dE by dt plus dP by rho by dt. If I expand this TB, d of P by rho by dt, I get 1 by rho dP by dt minus P by rho square d rho by dt. So, 1 by rho d p by d t is equal plus, what is this p by d rho plus p by rho squared, d rho by d t is what? D rho by d t, continuity equation says d rho by d t plus rho del dot v equal to 0. Remember, whatever equation I am deriving, I have never made any simplification till now incompressible. This equation is still valid for compressible. So, for this is the compressible, this is the general equation continuity. For d rho by d t, I can substitute as mo minus rho del dot v. So, that is minus into minus becomes plus p by rho squared rho into del dot v is del u by del x plus del v by del y equal to 1 by rho d p by d t plus rho rho gets cancelled, p by rho del u by del x plus del v by del y. So, now what am I going to do? I will substitute this for d h by d t. D h by d t equal to, I will substitute this complete thing for d e by d t, I can substitute as d h by d t minus d by d t of p by rho in my energy equation. This energy equation is what I have borrowed from previous transparency. So, that is d h by d t equal to, this is all d e by d t, that is this term, and this is this term, plus I am not writing all of this, I am just writing that as phi by rho, because this is my phi, plus where did this come from? This is nothing but my d p by d of p by rho by d t, which is given by these two terms, that is what I have written here. So, this term and this term get cancelled out and I get d h by d t equal to k by rho del square t by del x square plus del square t by del y square plus 1 by rho d p by d t plus phi by rho. So, yes, the last step, we are there, we do not have to be really impatient. Okay. So, that is d h by d t equal to k by rho, I think at least this step we shall write, that is, I want all of you to write along with me, so that we do not lose each other. D h by d t, equal to k by rho, del squared t by del x squared plus del squared t by del y squared plus 1 by rho d p by d t plus 1 by rho d p by d t plus phi by rho. Do not forget, phi is nothing but viscous dissipation term, it just contains viscosity and velocity gradients, that is both normal and also the shearing. Okay. So, now what is that I need to substitute? I substitute for h equal to C p into t. Okay. So, if I substitute that, what do I get? Rho C p, of course, I am taking this rho C p as constant properties, I get d t by d t equal to, do I do that? Let me check it out. Yes. For constant specific heat and for constant density, I get this, because these are, I am taking it out now. So, I get k by rho, only k, right, k into, because I am multiplying by rho, sorry. See, what am I putting? H equal to C p into t. So, that means, when I am pulling that C p outside, all that I am assuming is C p constant, not rho as constant. I am just multiplying by rho. Why I said that very carefully? Because I have still now not made any assumption that my flow is incompressible. That is very important. That was a wrong statement what I did 2 minutes back. So, I am just multiplying by rho. That does not make rho is constant. Okay. So, rho C p k del square t by del x squared plus del square t by del y squared plus d p by d t plus phi by plus phi. Okay. So, this I think at least we can realize the way how we see. Now, let us expand this d t d t term also. Rho C p, what is this d t? I think I had taken the last time example, you should be able to write this very easily. del T by del T plus U del T by del X, sorry, plus del V del T by del Y equal to K del square T by del X square plus del square T by del Y square plus dP by dt plus 5. So, what is this term? This is the unsteady term. What is this term? This is the convection term. Remember, I had taken an example wherein which I move myself from an outside hot air room to AC room. My velocity is u and del T by del X is the velocity gradient which I experience because of my movement into an AC room. That is this convection term. So, that is why these are called as convection term. Why they are convection terms? Because temperature gradient is getting convected by virtue of velocity, by virtue of velocity. And what is this term? This is conduction and this is pressure term. And this is viscous dissipation term, viscous dissipation term. So, let me come back here, this is written it nicely here, convection term, conduction term, pressure work and viscous dissipation term. And now, I am handing over, no, do not worry about these two terms, you can very easily see these two terms, you will understand the importance of these two terms. Now, Professor Arun is going to non-dimensionalize these equations and explain us the significance of these terms. So, do not worry, keep your question for these two terms for a while. Professor Arun is going to teach us principle of similarity.
Okay, good morning. Just take up little bit from where Professor Prabhu had left. See, energy equation was derived with the idea, again just to re-emphasize in couple of minutes, that we want to find the temperature field. As I had told in conduction also, if I get the temperature distribution, I can get the gradient. So, I should not have equations in terms of derivatives of enthalpy, derivatives of internal energy, so on and so forth. So, the dependent variable, the primary dependent variable should become temperature. That is the first thing. Second thing is, I just remembered fleetingly when Professor Prabhu was doing this. Why is this not an acceptable form of the energy equation, this part? Okay, I convert this to temperature, what about these things? My primary dependent variables in all continuity momentum equation are velocity, u, v, w, if you are talking of three dimensions, and pressure. So, I do not like all this sigma x x, sigma y y, tau x x, tau y y, I do not like all those things, because my primary variables are u and v and w. So, these also necessarily have to be written in terms of the velocity gradients or velocity, derivatives of the velocity with respect to either x, y or z. That is why we go into so much details to convert all this to velocities and temperatures, where energy, these will be converted to temperatures, these will be converted to the velocity gradients. So, now what do I have as a result of all this algebra and 1 hour of discussion? I have one equation which essentially tells me how energy, how heat is going to get transported from one part of the fluid to another. And we said that this involves advection, which is convection, plus the conduction part. There is the pressure work, we will see what this is, there is what is called as a viscous dissipation. Dissipation, as we all know, is nothing but when we use the word dissipated means it is lost, it is going as a waste. So, this viscous dissipation term essentially is, where does it come from? Let us just go back to the physics. Where does this phi come from? This phi comes from this sigma etcetera, 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 which is here. So, in other words, look at this phi. This phi is gradients of velocity either in the direction of the velocity or in the direction of perpendicular to the direction of velocity. So, I have du by dx, dv by dy, du by dx, dv by dy, du by dy, dv by dx, so on and so forth. So, these are essentially the shear normal stresses and so on and so forth. What are they caused because of? They are caused because of viscosity. So, friction, as we know from high school, we have been studying, friction is bad because it involves loss of energy, it involves loss of power. And our simple example will be from riding a car or a vehicle or whatever, pushing a block on a table. You will say friction, larger the friction, greater is the power that I have to supply, it is going to go as a waste. So, here when I say this is energy, this is the shear and normal stresses, the work which is being lost because of the shear and the normal stresses. Can this be prevented? No, this cannot be prevented, because one layer of fluid is going to slide over another layer of fluid. There are bound to be rotational aspects, there are bound to be angular deformations of the fluid whenever the fluid is moving. So, maybe some of the terms here can become 0, but this term can never become equal to 0. Okay. So, what we are trying to say, this phi is a can we eliminate friction? We cannot eliminate friction. In fact, friction needs to be there in many applications, because otherwise things will just slide. So, in order that friction is there, we have to pay a penalty. Something useful is coming out of friction. So, we have to pay a penalty. That penalty is this loss of energy, which we call as the viscous dissipation. The word viscous implies it is coming because of viscosity. Dissipation implies it is a loss, it is going away, it is useless, you cannot retrieve it back, it is irreversible. If I have to go to thermodynamics and say, it is an irrevocable loss of energy. It is like, you know, to maintain a credit card, many times you have to pay an annual fee. Okay. That annual fee gives you the privileges of using that credit card wherever you want. So, that annual fee cannot be got back. So, same kind of thing. To have this flow, to have this energy transport, there has to be a penalty, there has to be a loss, which we call as the viscous dissipation. When will this be small? This will be small when the velocity gradients are small. That means, when the velocities are reasonably small, the gradients are expected to be small. So, probably in those cases, these terms can be small. They will never go to 0, they can be neglected, but they will never be equal to 0. Then other situations where the viscosity is much smaller, very small flows. In our fluid mechanics, we have dealt with potential flow solutions or where viscosity is neglected, inviscid flows that we have seen. In that case, if when mu is equal to 0 or very small, I can put this equal to 0. So, what am I trying to say all this? The physics of this is very important, okay? Because in most UG textbooks, undergraduate universities, colleges, I do not think this equation is derived. I may be wrong, but we do not derive this, but we do not even present this probably. Okay? But I think we have to at least show this, present this, and probably spend some time understanding what this is. So, this is the motion energy transport because the fluid is moving. Okay. This is the energy transport because of conduction. Even when velocity equal to 0, okay, even when the fluid is brought to rest, 0 velocities, this thing will go to 0, this thing will go to 0, this material derivative will go to 0, because this involves dp by dt, so on and so forth. Pressure is there only when there is a flow. You can look at it like that, or you can look at it from the fact of expanding this bracket, dp by dt plus u dp by dx plus v dp by dy. However way you look at this, this term is going to be 0 when velocities are 0, when the fluid is stationary. Phi, again remember, this phi was all viscous dissipation gotten due to velocity gradients. So, when the fluid is stationary, this whole thing is going to go to 0. What do I get back? I get back my nice beautiful conduction equation, two dimensional, k d square t by d x squared plus d square t by d y squared is equal to rho c p d t by d t. Bring this k down here, I will get d square t by d x squared plus d square t by d y squared is equal to 1 by alpha d rho d t by d d time. This was what we derived in the first or second lecture, heat diffusion equation. That was not from, did not jump from anywhere. It is essentially this energy equation where all the velocities, all the flows were brought to 0. So, this general energy equation, we cannot say it is only conduction based or convection related, or it is the most general equation. And again, where did this come from? This came from your dear first law of thermodynamics. So, what you have seen in thermodynamics is this. Now, I am putting, first law of thermodynamics was Q minus dE by dT is equal to Q dot minus W dot plus so on and so forth. That Q dot and W dot were all black boxes. You were supplied Q's or W's, you had to calculate other quantities. So, you did not care whether this Q was lost by conduction, convection, radiation. Now, we are saying I know little bit more than what I knew when I knew thermodynamics. So, I will write expressions for Q and W. What are these W's? These W's are caused because of the shear and the normal stresses. Okay. So, with this so much of talk on this energy equation, I hope the physics of this thing is clear. In our sleep after doing this heat transfer course, I think we have to be able to write this form, at least this form. Okay, three dimensional if you cannot write, it is okay. Two dimensional we should be able to write. And a word of caution, all participants have to, the slides are there with you. It is about few pages of algebra. We urge all of you to please go and derive this equation. Okay. Where we will ask you on during the final test on Friday, you will definitely see a question related to energy equation in some form. Okay. So, we urge all of you, even though this is given to you a priori, please derive every step, put in the maths here, fill in the blanks. Those of you who are not participants and sitting here also should derive this equation. Step by step you come up with the final form, substitute for these sigmas x, sigma y, put it here and indeed show that viscous dissipation is like this. And then come up with this final form after all the algebra. We want you to do this, we urge you to do this, we will test you on this also. Okay. So, now we will go to the, okay, I have got temperature distribution, a solution of the, what kind of a differential equation is this? This is a real messy equation, meaning it has independent variables x, y and t. Dependent variable is temperature. Also, let me go back to viscous dissipation. Phi is here, this one. But what is phi? That phi is this part, correct? So, if I want to rewrite this equation, I will write this as rho Cp dT by dT plus u dT by dx plus v dT by dy equal to k d square t by dx square plus d square t by dy square plus dP by dT plus viscous dissipation. I do not remember directly. I will write it here from the document and you will see that. 2 mu d square u by dx square, 2 mu du by dx square plus 2 mu dv by dy plus mu du by dy plus dv by dx whole square plus mu du by dy plus dv by dx whole square minus 2 by 3 mu, this one minus 2 by 3 mu du by dx plus dv by dy whole square. Okay, why did I write this? Just a minute, we will see why did I write this. This one is written because we want to try to understand what are the dependent and independent variables. So, my continuity equation, this is my energy equation. continuity equation was du by dx plus dv by dy is equal to 0, if I call it unsteady, or if I want to write it in this form, I will write d rho by dt plus I will write it in this form. So, my variables are, if I look at this, temperature, u and v. Oh, okay. So, I wanted to derive an energy equation where temperature was the dependent variable. I wanted to get what? Temperature distribution, to get what? Heat transfer coefficient. Can I do it directly? If I have a differential equation d squared y by dx squared plus dy by dx plus y equal to 0, where I have only independent variable x and dependent variable y, I can solve to get y. Right now, if you see here, this is an equation which involves three variables. Dependent variables are t, okay, which we have not seen before, but u and v, which we have carried forward from continuity and momentum equation. So, I cannot solve this independently. What does that mean? I have to be able to get u's and v's from the momentum continuity equation to substitute that here, substitute for u's and v's here, then I will get differential equation which has only temperature as the dependent variable. So, very, very important thing from fundamentals point of view is that this continuity equation gives me u v. Can I solve this and get both? No. One equation, two unknowns, not possible to get both. Okay, very good. Then momentum equation, x momentum, y momentum, it gives me u v and p. Okay. So, this I can probably solve, three equations, x, y momentum, continuity equation, three unknowns. What are the three unknowns? U, v and p. So, it is the closed system of equation. When I have number of equations is equal to number of unknowns, I can solve it. Yeah, solution techniques might be difficult, might be lengthy, but we can solve it on paper at least. Energy equation now gives me what? Is it a vector or a scalar? It is a scalar. So, I have only one equation. It looks, from that point of view, energy is good. It has only one equation. Momentum is a pain because I have x, y, z, three equation, vector quantity. Here I have t, u, v, what else? Pressure. So, I have all these things. So, typically what I have to do is, these have to be solved together simultaneously. Either I should get the flow distribution, flow field, substitute for the flow distribution and then get t as the function of x, y, z and t. Okay. So, we cannot just get t independent. What I am trying to say, conduction, nothing was there. So, I could get t directly. Here, I need to be able to understand the physics of the flow from these two equations, continuity and momentum, get the velocity distribution, substitute that here and then be able to get the temperature distribution. Once I get the temperature distribution, I can do the heat transfer coefficient, etcetera. So, that is what we will do. What are you trying to do now? Okay, first we will simplify this and try to throw away terms as we have done, because we do not like to carry such a big equation with so many terms. So, first assumption we make is steady flow. So, steady flow means this whole thing does not become 0. Please bear in mind, for those of you who are unable to see this, professor has already expanded this on the whiteboard. Let us go back here. This is the expansion of dt by dt. This expansion, when I say it is for steady flow, this term will go to 0. These two will remain. Similarly, dp by dt when expanded will have partial derivative of pressure with respect to time, that will go to 0, these terms will remain. So, I will have this form of the equation. Okay. Now, when I why do I need to non-dimensionalize? What is the reason for this non-dimensionalization? Because normally what we try to do is, in any system of equation when we have to solve, we have to take into account various non-dimensional quantities which might affect the distribution. So, in fluid mechanics, we knew Reynolds number affected the distribution. Okay. That Reynolds number, etcetera, how did it come? So, that is what we are trying to see. If x star, this is again just algebra, so we will go quickly. X star is x by L, y star is y by L. What is this L? We will leave it for now. This L is a characteristic length scale. This question was asked in the Moodle forum. Why do we take L? What is the characteristic dimension for Nusselt number and Biot number? Are they the same? One was V by A surface area, another we use L or D depending on what we want. It is not D by 2, D by 3, etcetera. Why? The question is answered by this. See, this is a representative scale of in the x direction, this characteristic dimension. It has nothing to do with the volume, surface area, etcetera. That Biot number definition of characteristic length was a result of writing energy transfer by convection on this outside to energy transfer by conduction through the solid. You came up with V by As, and that V by As represents a length because it is of the units meter. We call it as a characteristic length, and we give it different things for plane wall, L by 2 for a plane wall of thickness L, it will come as L by 2, so on and so forth. Okay. So, that has nothing to do with this. This is a length scale. Okay. So, what could be the length scales for a flat plate of length L of 1 meter? That 1 meter is a representative length scale, meaning the physical dimension which is important, that is the length scale. I cannot have size of this room when I am doing an experiment of the where the plate is of this dimension, because it has to be related to the problem. Okay. Now, why in a pipe flow diameter is the characteristic dimension and length is not the characteristic dimension, that we will see when we go to internal flows. So, do not break your head on that. Our request to you, actually most participants, is put questions on Moodle for things that have been covered till that day, because most questions I have answered have been, please wait, we will see that later. Okay. Because many times writing an answer is basically reinventing the wheel, since we are going to study it here anyway. So, u star, let us scale the velocity by u, u star is equal to u by v. Now, what is this v? There is a question again on that. What velocity is this? Flat plate, we have understood, we know, we are acclimatized with what we call as free stream velocity. So, that could be the free stream velocity. In internal flows, is there a free stream velocity? No, there is no free stream velocity. Fluid will come in, so, and it will become some kind of a velocity profile will be there, and this this v could be the average velocity. Okay. So, we have used all these, unknowingly we have used brute force, we have used. Now, we are going to see why we are using what we are using. Then pressure p star is non-dimensionalized by half rho v square. What is this half rho v square? We could have used 1/2 rho v square, but we are just using rho v square. This rho v square represents what? All of us know this. All static, dynamic, all these things, right? So, this represents the dynamic pressure. And T star, T star is a non-dimensional temperature scale. What is that? How many temperatures are involved in the heat transfer problem? That is very important. In fluid mechanics, we had U local, U free stream. We did not have U surface, because that was 0, because of no slip condition. Even the if the surface had a velocity, by relative velocity concept, that could be brought to 0. Therefore, we say you had a local velocity U, you had a free stream velocity U infinity, only 2 variables. Whereas, in heat transfer, unfortunately, I have 3 variables: local temperature, surface temperature, free stream temperature T infinity. Okay. So, these have to be taken together. And why do we take this? Who has given me this bright idea that it has to be like that? This bright idea essentially comes from this fact that T star, somebody has told me, this is T s minus T local divided by T s minus T infinity. Why T s minus T? Why not T minus T infinity? Okay. So, the answer lies in this fact. So, if I have a flat plate which is at temperature T s, fluid is coming in at free stream temperature T infinity. Cold air at 30 degrees centigrade is flowing over a hot plate which is at 100 degrees centigrade. Classic simple problem. There will be some kind of a boundary layer formed, we have understood all that. There will be a temperature distribution which will go like this. This also we have understood. What are we saying? This is the surface temperature. This at any point is the local fluid temperature. T infinity is something which is on the outside, unaffected temperature beyond the boundary layer. So, this T minus T s is representing what? A local temperature difference between what? This is a local temperature, everybody agrees, or between what is necessary for heat transfer. For heat transfer to occur, there has to be a temperature difference. This denominator represents the maximum possible temperature difference that the fluid can experience. This represents the local temperature difference that the fluid experiences between when this fluid at say 45 degrees centigrade and this is at 30, this is at 100. What we are saying is this fluid cannot carry it. Fluid particle at this temperature 45 cannot carry as much heat away with it as a particle at 30 degrees centigrade can carry. That is the heat transfer characteristic. Because of a higher temperature, it has lost some of it. So, this temperature ratio is going to always be between 0 and 1. That is the way we look at non-dimensional quantities. We non-dimensionalize typically such that the non-dimensional parameter lies between 0 and 1. That is a general rule, okay, such that the non-dimensional parameter lies between 0 and 1. At the surface, what are we going to have? At the surface, we are going to have this become equal to T s minus T s 0. At the free stream, T infinity minus T s divided by T infinity minus T s non-dimensional temperature becomes equal to 1. Take the case for velocity. Free stream u is same as v, it will become 1. So, that is the way. Now, what I do is I substitute for, we have done non-dimensionalization before. So, I am not going to redo this whole thing as we did, because it is essentially algebra. I will just show you one term, you can do the other things from point of view of homework. So, first thing that we will see is this rho Cp u dt by dx I will show, and then the remaining you can do rho Cp u dt by dx. This is what we are going to non-dimensionalize. We have u star is equal to u by v. So, therefore, I will write u is equal. What is my aim? I want to throw away all the variables u, v, t, x, etcetera, and write it in terms of a non-dimensional quantity. So, this I will substitute. What else is there? X by L is x star. So, I can write dx is equal to, I will write it a little big, dx is equal to L times dx star. This is one thing. Third thing is T s minus T divided or T minus T s is equal to T divided by T infinity minus T s is T star. Why can't it be the other way? It can be the other way, T s minus T divided by T s minus T infinity. I keep it this way because I want T easily taken out without doing algebra for minus sign. So, this will tell me T infinity minus T s is constant. So, I can write this like this, T infinity minus T s times T star. Differentiate this. So, d t is nothing but derivative of T s is 0. So, this goes to 0, derivative of this quantity is 0, T infinity minus T s is a constant. So, that stays as it is, I get d t star. So, now I am going to substitute all this here. So, rho Cp u, instead of u I am going to use v times u star. D by d x is replaced by 1 by L d by d x star. is that correct? D x is being replaced by L d x star from here. What am I left? D t. D t therefore is going to be d t star times t infinity minus t s. I will just unfortunately keep it like this. This I can write therefore as rho c p v t infinity minus t s divided by L u star d t star by t x star. Is that correct? Next term I will get, second term of the equation I will get rho c p, without even seeing I am going to write, let me see if I do it correctly, rho c p v t infinity minus t s divided by L v star d t star divided by t y star. This is the left hand side of my energy equation. Okay. Is that correct? Let us see. Rho c p v, this one, please look here, rho c p v t infinity minus t s by L u star d t star by d x star plus v star. Please note here, please note this term, second term of the first bracket, left hand side, the stars are missing. Stars are missing. This is v star d t star by d y star, and that missing gets carried over all through this derivation. So, please make a note, this term does not have a star by mistake, please write it. Okay. And the right hand side, if I non dimensionalize, I will get similar kind of terms. What am I trying to do? We will just see in a minute. Viscous dissipation, I have expanded. I have written those 6 terms associated with viscous dissipation. No, that also needs to be non dimensionalized. Okay. So, I will substitute all the V's and U's and so on and so forth, and try to non dimensionalize this. Du by dx therefore would become V du star by L dx star, that is what is there. Square of that, you will get V squared by L squared. Okay. So, this whole thing is a non dimensionalized viscous dissipation. This is the non dimensionalized conduction term. Okay. This is the non dimensionalized pressure work term. Okay. How did you get V squared? Because pressure is non dimensionalized by a factor which has V squared already, and then there is a U which will have a V when it is non dimensionalized. So, I have rho V cubed coming in here, and this is phi star mu V squared by L squared times a bunch of terms associated with that. What is that bunch of terms associated with that? What will happen to that? We will see. Okay. So, this is the non-dimensional form. What is the use? Let us just do the algebra. I do not like all this. Even after non-dimensionalization, I would want the equation to look in a similar form. So, what am I doing next? So, this rho v c p L t infinity minus t s, I will take to the other side. So, my left hand side of this non-dimensionalized equation, I would want like this only. That is u star d t star by d x star plus v star d t star by d y star. This is the left hand side I want. Why do I want this? We will see in just a minute. Equal to, I will take all those things, several terms are there, I will divide by this rho v c p t infinity minus t s, several terms will be there. Okay. When I do all that and do a bunch of things which I have to do for algebra, I will come up with this very very nice form that I will rewrite here after lot of algebra. I will get, so, u star d t star by d x star plus v star d t star by d y star. This is the left hand side of the equation. What was the left hand side of the dimensional equation? The dimensional equation was this. Okay. Rho c p, let me not worry about it for now. I will write it. The dimensional equation was rho Cp u dT by dx plus v dT by dy, something like that. So, I am having now the non-dimensional part essentially the same thing, u star, d star, x star, so like that I am having, and the right hand side comes out to be 1 over r e p r. Did we non-dimensionalize the momentum equation? We have not. When you non-dimensionalize the momentum equation, in fact, you will see, we will do it next step, you will see r e coming in there. Okay. 1 by r e p r d square t star by d x star squared plus d square t star by d y star squared plus v squared by c p t infinity minus t s u star d p star by d x plus v star d p star by d y star, see I missed the star here, plus phi star mu v rho c p l t infinity minus t s. Okay. So, what is the great deal that we have done? We have tried to keep the equation in a similar form except bring some coefficients in front of them. Okay. Right hand side I had conduction term d square t by d x square plus d square t by d y square. Instead of that I have the star terms, but in front of it I have something which I like, Reynolds and Prandtl number. Oh, Reynolds number rings a bell, fluid mechanics, somewhere we are getting connected now. This was the pressure work term, it had what? Material derivative of pressure. Okay. So, steady flow we drop the time derivative, and then you would have had u d p by d x plus v d p by d y. I have a similar form with some coefficient in front of it. Last term was viscous dissipation phi, I have a similar term with some coefficient in front of it, and the left hand side was essentially that rho c p u d t by d x term. I have brought rho c p down and I have got a similar term on the left hand side. What are the dimensions of this? Dimensions of the original equation was energy, right? That is, what is energy? It was actually in terms of watts, u dT by dx rho c p etcetera, right? Conduction term, all these things would give us in terms of watts, whereas this is a non-dimensional equation. Why is non-dimensionality so important? It is very important because if I have any situation, any flow situation, any heat transfer situation, the non-dimensionalization will give me a solution which if I cast the problem in terms of a non-dimensional quantity, if I know the solution of a non-dimensional equation and if I can cast the new problem in terms of similar non-dimensional numbers, I already have a solution in place. I can use it directly. Okay. So, this is the non-dimensional energy equation. Now, we will call this v squared by c p t infinity minus t s. We will call this as the Eckert number E c. What is this? It essentially again comes from interconversion of kinetic energy and enthalpy. If you realize your first law of thermodynamics, for a nozzle when you wrote, nozzle is a device where interconversion of kinetic energy and enthalpy occurs, right? H plus V squared by 2 is equal to H E plus V squared by 2. For an ideal gas, delta H would be C p delta T. So, C p delta T is equal to V squared exit minus V square inlet by 2. Similar thing, this shows the effectiveness or how good is this conversion from sensible or kinetic energy to sensible heat is there, and that is what is given here in the non-dimensional equation. Eckert number is the measure of dissipation effects in the flow. That is, since this grows in proportion to the square of the velocity, how
what is happening in a nozzle?
Velocity is increasing, enthalpy is getting converted, decreasing, right. So, if I just go back to nozzle, because that probably people can connect quite easily, let us just go here. I would have first law, I am just writing h I plus V I squared by 2 is equal to h E plus V E squared by 2. So, this I V I squared minus V E squared by 2, or let me write it the other way, because nozzle exit velocity is more. V E squared minus V I squared by 2 is equal to h I minus h E, which is nothing but C P T I minus T E, correct. So, V E squared minus V I squared is equal to 2 C P T I minus T E. What does this tell me? Exit velocity is more, greater than 0, that means this is greater than 0, T I is higher than T E. Temperature has gone down as the velocity has increased. So, interconversion of this to this has happened. Eckert number is trying to tell me that only. Okay. How much, how is this dissipation of velocity is getting converted to heat, kinetic energy is getting converted to heat, velocity has no meaning here, kinetic energy is getting converted to heat, first law only, nothing else here. Okay. So, since this quantity has V squared, we are going to have this quantity very important in high speed flows. Okay. And the second term, that viscous dissipation term, comes out to be phi star Eckert by Reynolds number. Okay. So, when is Eckert number important? Eckert number is important in high speed flows. It can be neglected for small velocities. So, incompressible flow situations that we are going to study in this part of heat transfer course, we will not take this term and this term into account. That means what? These are negligible compared to these terms, that is what we are saying. It is not equal to 0, it will be there, there will be a finite value, there will be an effect of velocity and on temperature, interconversion will happen, Eckert number will be there. But compared, order of magnitude, compared to the convection term and the heat conduction term, the viscous dissipation term and the pressure work term can be neglected. Okay. So, Eckert number, as a simple example given, velocity is 10 meter per second, the temperature difference reference state is 10 Kelvin, Eckert number is 0.01. When the temperature difference is larger, Eckert number still goes smaller. In typical speeds now that we see water or air or whatever, you will see 10 or such velocities for water, smaller velocities for incompressible fluids, this number would still be small. Therefore, we can throw away these two terms. And when I throw away these two terms, now you will appreciate that this equation, which is left with only the non-dimensional left hand side, what am I left with? Non-dimensional u star dt star by dx star plus v star dt star by dy star is equal to 1 by r e p r d squared t star by dx star squared plus d squared t star by dy star squared. Okay. This is a much more tractable equation in terms that this is only a number in front of me, as opposed to bunch of terms which were there. Why did we do this non-dimensionalization? If we had not done this non-dimensionalization, never in my sleep I would have known that viscous dissipation could be negligible for normal regular low speed situations, nor would I have known how to carry this pressure work term. Now, because of non-dimensionalization, I have understood that I can throw away these two terms at least for low speed flow situations. Okay. So, with this background, let us just quickly go to the combined. Now we have to see everything in full perspective. The continuity equation is here, two dimensional continuity equation, viscous dissipation neglected, pressure work term neglected, we have thought of steady flow situation, incompressible, laminar flow with constant properties, this is my continuity equation, this is my what momentum? X momentum equation. We will see what happens to y momentum equation. Rho u du by dx plus v du by dy is equal to mu d squared u by dx squared minus dp by dx, and this is the energy equation. Just chew on this during the tea break. These two equations look identical. If rho and rho cp you do not worry about, or take the rhos on that side, left hand side is identical, except that the form of the equation is identical, except that you have, instead of u here, you have a t here, you have a u here, you have a t here, u squared by y squared, t squared by y squared, t squared by x squared, and there is a dp by dx, okay. Something else is there. When dp by dx goes to 0, the nature or the appearance at least of this dimensional form of the equation looks the same, okay.